Good afternoon to everyone present here. So this IC is mainly related to intraocular tumors, and we have a good group of presenters who will be taking us to different aspects of intraocular tumors. I will be kickstarting this session with my presentation on intraocular vascular lesions. So I will be going through certain differential diagnosis of these vascular lesions, their diagnostic characteristics, and their systemic significance. We'll start off with choroidal hemangioma. It is one of the most common vascular lesions that are seen in the fundus. It's basically a vascular hamartoma which presents with metamorphopsia, blurred vision, induced hypermetropia, increased intraocular pressure, among other symptoms. It can be either circumscribed or it can be in the diffuse form with a nodular component. So clinically, it has a reddish orange to yellow hue, and it is most likely will be found closer to the posterior pole. Thickness varies from about 1 to 3 millimeters, and it usually has some amount of RP degeneration because these are long-standing lesions, and active lesions do have subretinal fluid that can be seen around the lesions as serous retinal detachment. Diffuse choroidal hemangiomas have a more saturated red appearance to the fundus, and the choroid is thickened diffusely as it can be seen on ultrasonography. If this thickening is more prominent around the disc, it may make it look like there is prominent optic disc cupping. These patients usually have Sturge-Weber syndrome, and that's why they might have elevated intraocular pressures associated. Again, RPE changes and serous retinal detachment are commonly found in these patients. This is the autofluorescence, which shows hypoautofluorescent patches in the region of the actual lesion. And wherever there is subretinal fluid, you do see this RPE hyperactivity as this hyperautofluorescent lesions. OCT is good to demonstrate this dome-shaped lesion, which is basically occupying the middle and the outer layers of the choroid with no choriocapillaris compression. Subretinal fluid and intraretinal fluid is easily seen on OCT, and OCT is a good tool for monitoring the activity of this lesion. The ultrasound is the one that really gives away the diagnosis. Basically, there's this acoustically solid dome-shaped mass with high internal reflectivity seen on A scan, which is basically due to the multiple vascular channels within the lesion. The fundus fluorescein angiography shows this early, very early hyperfluorescent lesion or filling up of the vascular channels within the mass itself. And towards the late frames, it undergoes staining and some amount of leakage where there is subretinal fluid. The ICG is another modality which is actually better to delineate these lesions. And it also shows within 30 seconds, the lesion kind of fills up and there's progressive hypersinescence, which is seen after 3 to 4 minutes into this investigative modality. Diffuse choroidal hemangiomas, as I previously mentioned, is associated with Sturge-Weber syndrome, which can be easily seen in this boy as this porcine stain. They're more commonly associated with glaucoma, but we should be careful looking out for this diffuse choroidal hemangioma as it may be associated with a lot of subretinal fluid and secondary retinal detachment. Treatment is mean if it's a small lesion, it can be amenable to local treatments like photodynamic therapy, TTT, laser. If there are larger lesions, they might require EBRT or plaque radiotherapy, or even Gamma knife radiosurgery has been tried. Anti-VEGF agents and oral propranolol have been used to a certain degree with moderate success. This is a patient who has undergone of diffuse choroidal hemangioma, who has undergone plaque brachytherapy with good resolution and stable follow-up 1 year post-treatment. The next lesion we'll be talking about is retinal capillary hemangioma. It's basically a benign vascular lesion, which is a red-yellow lesion with this dilated feeder artery and feeder draining vein. Average age of presentation is about 15 to 35 years. The lesion is most often, like 84% of them are associated with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. And in this case, they tend to be multiple and bilateral. These are some of photographs showing these fat dilated feeder vessels, which lead up to this large lesion. Optic fundus photography really helps because you can see these peripheral lesions along with the associated retinal detachment, and some very subtle lesions may be seen more easily. Fluorescein angiography is really important because some of these lesions are so small you might miss it on fundus examination. They fill up rapidly, the feeding artery, the lesion itself, and the draining vein, they fill up very rapidly with fluorescein leakage. As you can see in this photograph, it is very good for diagnosing occult lesions. Small lesions may be observed or may be amenable to local therapy. Larger lesions might require vitreoretinal surgery. Orthopropranolol and anti-VEGF agents have had equivocal results. The most important thing is the systemic screening, because these, as part of the VHL syndrome, CNS hemangioblastomas, RCCs, pheochromocytomas may be seen. So it is recommended that patients undergo physical examination, dilated fundus examination, urinary metanephrines, and abdominal ultrasound yearly, along with supplemental abdominal and brain MRI. The next lesion is retinal cavernous hemangioma. It's very classic. It looks like this bunch of grapes appearance. It's mainly centered around the optic disc and in the macular area. They are basically comprised of thin-walled channels with surface, vascular channels with surface gliosis and non-penetrated endothelium. They're usually sporadic and asymptomatic unless they involve the macula or have some bleeding associated. What is characteristic is this, it's fluorescein angiography, where you see this layer appearance. Due to the slow flow of blood through these lesions, the plasma is separated in the upper section and the erythrocytes settled at the bottom. So the upper part is more hyperfluorescent and the lower part is hypofluorescent, giving this layered appearance. There is no leakage of these lesions. These lesions may be easily observed and only be treated if they are symptomatic. This is one of our departmental publications where an infant presenting with APROP also had a retinal cavernous hemangioma, but since it was asymptomatic, it was left alone and it has been stable. The next lesion is racemose angioma of the retina. It's basically associated with Wyburn-Mason syndrome, in which there are arteriovenous malformations of the brain, orbit, retina, and skin. More often than not, there is focal involvement that is seen. These are the fat dilated vessels that you can see arising from the disc. Whenever you see this, more it almost clinches the diagnosis. These AVMs were classified according to their severity, with a group 3 having complex and extensive AVMs, which tend to have more complications and are more symptomatic. These retinal AVMs can lead to retinal detachment, macular edema, vitreous hemorrhage, retinal vascular occlusions, and at later stages, neovascular glaucoma, optic atrophy, and visual field defects. FA demonstrates rapid filling of these lesions, and it helps in categorizing into the groups of AVMs that we previously saw, but there is no leakage from these vessels that is seen. It is very important for all these patients to undergo an MRI or MRA to rule out any cerebral AVMs. Treatment is only done in case of complications. Otherwise, the retinal lesions are regularly monitored. The next lesion is vasoproliferative retinal tumor. They're basically a red, irregular nodules that are seen in the periphery of the retina between the equator and the aura. They are yellow-red and ill-defined, more commonly found inferiorly or inferotemporally. They're basically comprised of glial cells and a network of capillaries with some larger dilated blood vessels. They may be the primary in most cases or secondary to retinitis pigmentosa, pars tinnitus, Coats disease, amongst other conditions. So the problem with these lesions is that even though they're actually small, they tend to have an exuberant exudation, which often reaches the macula, causing decreased vision. Epiretinal membranes are also found very often with these lesions. So the treatment is local therapy, mainly in the form of cryotherapy, laser, PDT, or plaque radiotherapy. This leads to a resolution of subretinal fluid and eventually the mastome. Just to kind of put everything else together, there are a few iris vascular lesions which are usually benign. Iris capillary hemangiomas may be associated with eyelid and orbital capillary hemangiomas. Iris cavernous hemangiomas are known, and racemose hemangiomas are also known. They're basically benign conditions that can be watched. So to summarize, we have gone through a lot of intraocular vascular lesions, their classic clinical appearance, and ancillary testing, especially FFA, is very useful in diagnosing these conditions. We have seen the systemic implications, especially in case of retinal capillary hemangioma, cavernous hemangioma, and racemose angioma. These patients should undergo, at least on the first visit and follow-up visits, a good brain and brain MRI. And MRA. I would like to acknowledge Dr. Santosh Nawar for the photographs and for giving me all this knowledge, and also the Retina Department at Advanced Eye Center to help me for helping me with all the photographs. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Samiksha. That was very nice and the lucid presentation. You covered almost everything of this. I'm sorry for the technical glitch that I would like to start introduction after the first batsman has already finished the inning. It's a very good afternoon, everyone, and welcome all to the first ever virtual AIOC. I would like to thank the AIOS organizing committee and the scientific committee for giving us opportunity to be here. And today we will be discussing intraocular tumor, decipher the code. This is one of the tumors which are seen by everyone from general ophthalmologist to the retinal surgeons. And many of the times the diagnosis is missed or the certain investigations which are very important are not being done. So this is basically to cover all the types of intraocular tumors. And for that we have esteemed panel with us. And Dr. Samiksha has started already with her presentation, and she has done her fellowship from Center for Sight, and then she was with Dr. Carol Shields at Wilson Institute, and at present she is working as a consultant in PGI. Dr. Samiksha, I would like to ask one question to you here is, out of all the vascular lesions that you presented, which do you think or in your experience is most commonly encountered in the clinical scenario?
Usually choroidal hemangiomas are quite commonly encountered in the clinical scenario. Often they are missed or misdiagnosed. So it's very important to get an FA done or ICG if it's available, and it can just the diagnosis quite easily. It's just you have to look for it.
Thank you, Dr. Samiksha. So now we'll move on to our second talk, and it's by Dr. Raksha Rao. Ma'am, you can start sharing the screen. Dr. Raksha Rao finished her MS from Nair Hospital, and then she did her fellowship with Center for Sight, Dr. Santosh Unnava, sir, and then she was at Wilson Institute with Dr. Carol Shields and Jerry Shields. At present, she is a consultant at Narayan Netralaya, Bangalore. Very warm welcome, ma'am, and she'll be talking about choroidal metastasis, the color speak. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit, for the introduction. So I'll be talking on choroidal metastasis. So choroidal mets is the most common intraocular malignancy in adults. It presents with blurred vision most commonly, but it can also present with flashes, floaters, or metamorphosia when the foveal, there is subretinal fluid accumulation right under the fovea. So this is one of the largest series of patients with uveal metastasis, which was published by Dr. Shields et al., the group from Wilson Institute. And in their study, they found that of all the uveal metastasis, 92% was found in choroid and the rest in ciliary body and iris. The predisposition for choroidal metastasis as compared to any other intraocular structure can be explained by the choroidal blood flow, which has a luxurious blood supply. See, as in this graph, you can compare the blood flow to the retina, which is just 25 ml per minute per 100 gram. Brain, which we think is a very vascular structure, the blood flow is 75 ml per minute per 100 gram. And as compared to these two structures, you can see the choroidal blood supply is very, very high, and it is to the tune of 1000 to 2000 ml per minute per 100 gram. So this luxurious blood supply provides a very good avenue for the embolus from the primary tumor to get sequestered within the choroidal channels and provides an environment where they can further proliferate. So among all the primary tumors that metastasize to choroid, breast carcinoma is the most common, followed by lung carcinoma, kidney, GI, prostate, and thyroid. And if you talk about sex-wise ratio, amongst males, lung carcinoma is the most common tumor to metastasize to the choroid, whereas in females, it is the breast carcinoma. So at the time of diagnosis of choroidal metastasis, the primary cancer is known prior to the choroidal metastasis diagnosis in about two-thirds of the patients. But in about 17% of the patients, the choroidal mets is the first symptom of any primary tumor. In about 16% of the patients, the primary cancer is never found or is cryptic. So most commonly, the choroidal metastasis is unilateral and unifocal. In some cases, up to 20%, it can be bilateral. And again, in some cases, it can be multifocal. And as many as 20 to 30 tumors can be found per eye. In general, lung carcinoma tends to be unilateral and unifocal, and breast carcinoma tends to be bilateral and multifocal. So going by the color, we recognize the choroidal mets by way of color, which can help us indicate what the primary tumor site is. So when the choroidal mets is yellow, that means the primary tumor is likely to be breast, lung, GI, prostate, or the esophagus. When the choroidal mets is brown, the most common primary site is cutaneous melanoma or melanoma of the contralateral eye. When the choroidal mets is orange, the likely primary tumor site is carcinoid, which can be lung carcinoid or any other systemic organ. It can be thyroid CA or renal cell carcinoma. On ultrasound, choroidal metastasis is typically echo-dense as compared to choroidal melanoma, which tends to be acoustically hollow. And typically, the choroidal mets is associated with a large amount of subretinal fluid. On OCT, we typically describe the choroidal mets as lumpy, bumpy deposit, which is the contour that is produced by the uneven surface of the choroidal mets. So the most common differential diagnosis is amelanotic melanoma, choroidal granuloma, and choroidal hemangioma. So the diagnosis of choroidal mets can be arrived at by carefully examining the patient by establishing whether the tumor is unilateral, bilateral, multifocal, or unifocal, and with the help of all the ancillary testing, including FA, where typically the choroidal mets, as compared to choroidal melanoma, there is dilated retinal capillaries. On ultrasound, like I have already mentioned, the choroidal mets is echodense, whereas choroidal melanoma is acoustically hollow. EDI-OCT also is very typical of choroidal mets with lumpy, bumpy deposit. If there is any further doubt, we generally do an MRI scan or a fine needle aspiration biopsy, which helps in concreting the diagnosis. So once this diagnosis of choroidal mets is established, how would you further manage the patient? Now that depends on whether the primary tumor is already diagnosed or yet to be diagnosed in the patient. So the way to go about this is, once you diagnose choroidal mets, look for the primary tumor. If the patient is already diagnosed with the primary tumor and is on treatment, then wait for the response for the therapy to act on the choroidal mets. If there is good response, then you do nothing. There is no separate management for choroidal mets. So just continue to follow up, hoping that the systemic therapy would also heal the choroidal mets. However, if the choroidal mets is showing a poor response to systemic therapy, then you have to give a separate treatment for choroidal mets that can be plaque radiotherapy, EBRT, TGT, or proton beam radiotherapy. So at the time of detecting choroidal mets, if the patient was already diagnosed and treated for primary tumor and the tumor was regressed, then you refer the patient to a medical oncologist to look for the activity of the primary tumor, whether the primary tumor is reactivated or not, or you get a PET CT done. So if there is no reactivation of the primary tumor and there is no other tumor but only choroidal mets, then again you treat the choroidal mets with plaque radiotherapy, EBRT, TTT, or proton beam radiotherapy. However, if the primary tumor is reactivated or there is multi-system involvement, depending upon the number of systems involved, either you can initiate systemic therapy or you counsel the patient for palliative therapy under the care of a medical oncologist. Now, at the time of detection of choroidal mets, if the primary tumor is not known, again, you follow the same algorithm where you refer the patient to a medical oncologist to look for a primary or get a PET scan done. And if there is multi-system involvement, initiate systemic therapy or palliative therapy under the care of a medical oncologist. However, even after PET scan or further test, if the primary tumor continues to remain cryptic, that means we do not know the site of the primary tumor, you then try to salvage the eye by treating the choroidal mets, either by plaque radiotherapy, EBRT, TTT, or proton beam radiotherapy. However, one must know that despite any form of treatment, the average survival of a patient with uveal metastasis is about 21 months. And this is much lower in patients where the primary tumor is pancreas, where they do not generally survive beyond 4 to 5 months. And the survival is longest in whom the primary tumor is lung carcinoid, where they survive for an average about 60 months. We must know that choroidal metastasis tends to appear late in the course of malignancy. That means it is almost a part of the end stage disease of any cancer. And this is generally associated with disseminated disease and has much poor prognosis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Archa. That was a really nice presentation and eye-opener for everyone. That when you see a choroidal lesion, the primary workup is many times important because it could be a first feature of presenting the disease.
Absolutely.
So, Dr. Achai, I would like to ask one question.
Mm-hmm.
How often do we need to treat a choroidal mets with the radiation therapy after the primary tumor treatment has been done?
So, I have seen two patients so far, both females, both with breast carcinoma as the primary site, and both diagnosed when they were undergoing primary treatment for their primary tumor. So, both these patients responded very well to their hormone therapy because the choroidal mets were probably estrogen receptor positive. So, both of the patients responded well to hormone therapy. So, there was no active intervention necessary for the choroidal mets per se. So I would say that if the patients respond well to primary systemic therapy, then that's well and good. Otherwise, we might end up having to give them plaque radiation.
Okay. And once you find a choroidal mets and there is no primary known, like you have a choroidal which is
a primary tumor, yes.
Then the first investigation that you advise, is it a PET CT scan of the whole body or you go ahead?
The primary tumor cryptic, we label the patients as primary tumor cryptic when after doing a PET scan also you are unable to detect what the source of primary tumor is. So then you might want to do an FNAV so that you can detect the tissue that is present in the choroidal mets, whether you know there is any like a pancreatic adenocarcinoma when it metastasizes to the choroid, FNAV you can find some amount of the tissue. But again, if nothing is found, if for some reason FNAV is not possible, then you label the patient as the cryptic primary tumor, then you treat just the choroidal mets.
Thank you, Dr. Rakshama.
Thank you, Dr.
Now, I will move ahead with my own presentation here.
So let me introduce Dr. Sumit Lahane. Of course, he needs no introduction. He is quite a popular person amongst all academicians. He works in JJ Hospital in Mumbai after having completed two fellowships, one refractive surgery from Narayan Netralaya and oculoplasty oncology fellowship from under Dr. Santosh Hunawar at Hyderabad. So now he's currently working as an associate professor in JJ Hospital. Over to you, Dr. Sumit.
Thank you, Raksha ma'am, for that nice and kind introduction. You are one of the reasons for me joining a fellowship, so thank you so much. So I'll be talking about retinoblastoma, most common intraocular tumor. And why I would like to start with the history, there is a simple reason that I will tell you in my third slide is the first description was done way back by Petrus Povis, and it was described as some tumor resembling a retinoblastoma, and he thought it was a fungal mass basically. Then James Waldrop, he first proposed that the early enucleation of the involved eye might save the life of the patient. So this is how it was started with. And then when we see today, what was the management history? So it was enucleation as it was prescribed by popularized by Waldrop, then enucleation, radiation, chemotherapy. That's how the protocol was. Now today when we see, the protocol is totally reversed. It's chemotherapy, then radiation SOS, and then if still not salvageable, then only you go ahead with the enucleation. So there is 360 degree change in the current management compared to the old management. Now, how do you manage today? There are a lot of options of chemotherapy, focal therapy, radiotherapy, and enucleation. I will be just showing you this in the brief, that the chemotherapy can be given in the various ways, from intravenous, intraarterial, periocular, and intravitreal. Focal therapy consists majorly of the lasers, and the radiotherapy, EBRT, or the plaque brachytherapy. And the end is the enucleation. Options for treatment depend on the primary tumor or recurrence of the tumor, and again the size of the tumor. Now moving ahead with, since we are majorly focusing on the imaging and the diagnosis of the tumor here, what do we follow today? We follow international classification of the retinoblastoma given by Shields, and the classification which is of very most important in the developing countries like India is orbital retinoblastoma. It was given by our very own Santosh Unnava sir. And it is again classified into the five different classes. So primary, secondary, accidental, overt orbital, and microscopic orbital retinoblastoma. Metastatic retinoblastoma, the incidence is no less, but still it is seen, and the patient does come with the multisystem metastasis and the very poor salvage in such cases. So what are the features of the retinoblastoma? How do we not miss a retinoblastoma? How can it present in a various ways? So this is a very early presentation of the retinoblastoma. We must say that sometimes it presented as transparent small mass near the macula or near the arcade, that is the seed, and it is translucent and a very small feeder. As it increases in the size, it develops its own feeder vessels, or feeder vessel and the vein, and then it increases in the size, and there is subretinal exudate. This is an exophytic kind of a tumor, and this is whitish in lesion and the whitish in color and elevated. Now, this is a very classical picture when you see an optic disc with dilated feeder vessels, and there are two tumors, but inferior and one superior to the disc. The one which is seen yellowish, whitish yellow in color, basically it's one with the retina draped over the tumor. This is nothing but an exophytic type of a tumor. The another which you see, it comes with the penetration of the retina and it is growing inside the vitreous. This is endophytic type of the tumor. So majorly when you want to morphologically classify, you can call it as the exophytic tumor or the endophytic tumor, depending on the clinical examination. This is a large endophytic tumor. When it diagnosed in the late stage, you don't see anything. There is no view of the retina except for the few vessels, and you directly see a tumor mass. It becomes very difficult to diagnose at this stage in time. We do see such cases still today of orbital retinoblastoma, where the growth is protruding out. Patient does come with the proptosis and many times the intracranial extension. Now, what imaging you should do ideally once you see a case of retinoblastoma? Very important is you should do a examination under anesthesia, because children are not very cooperative with examination. You cannot do it like ROP screening, where you know where you are supposed to see the lesion. Retinoblastoma, it's not like that. It could be a multifocal involvement, it could be at the pars plana, it could be a very small tumor which you may miss. So whenever you are suspecting patient presenting with the features of leukocoria, it's very important that you should do a EUA. What else you can do is ultrasound scan, B scan, very classical shown ill-defined mass here with the specks of calcification. This is how the classical B scan of the retinoblastoma presents. Now, the other scene shown are basically pseudo-retinoblastoma. We will come to that each specifically, but here, since the picture is there, I would like to tell you this is again a irregular, ill-defined mass. Again, few specks of calcification, but not very well adhered to the retina here. This is nothing but a Coats disease. Here you see, finding this small connection between the retina moving to the lens again is difficult. This is what we find in a PHPV, where the traction, the retina has a traction, and it's basically a persistent hyoid artery which continues till the lens. This is familial exudative vitreoretinopathy. Here we said nodular astrocytoma. and he has nothing but a vitreous hemorrhage in a patient of the sickle cell anemia. So you need to look for calcification in such case. Again, only given a B scan, will you be able to diagnose this as a RB or not RB? No. Again, a clinical examination is must in such cases. Now, imaging wise, this is a CT scan picture of the two different retinoblastoma cases. Now, what do we should look for? Before that, should we do a CT scan in every case of the retinoblastoma? We may not suggest that you should do it in every case of the retinoblastoma. It's a focal tumor. The optic disc is very much visible. It is only at the macula, 3x4 millimeter tumor. And you may not in the stage A, or you just have a 3 millimeter tumor, you may not do a imaging in that case. But you have a large tumor where the posterior pole of the retina is not visible, imaging is must. CT scan can tell you a good status about optic nerve also. Here I would like to point out, see the normal optic nerve here and the normal contour of the optic nerve and basically thickness. Here when you see there are multiple calcific foci near the retina, which is very classical of the retinoblastoma, and you also see a thickening of the optic nerve. So what you must see in such cases is a calcification, extrascleral extension and the optic nerve extension, which is to be seen on this CT scan, which tells you that are you dealing with just the intraocular retinoblastoma or it has gone to the orbital stage, and accordingly you need to set your protocol. Now, why always CT scan? Do we do MRI ever, or is it that necessary that MRI has to be done? There is nothing like MRI has to be done in each and every bilateral retinoblastoma, and you want out that it's not a case of pineal blastoma. In those cases, MRI is very important to rule not a tumor. Otherwise, CT suffice. Now, this is just an example of a tumor to start with, and then post chemotherapy, it reduces to a very small size, and a patient has a salvage of the eye and the salvage of the vision in such cases. Now, how does retinal presentations? You need to know important ones. Very first is the leukochoria, or the poor vision, which is a white reflex. Many times the parents come that in the dark suddenly there is a reflex of the eye which is different, and this leukochoria is most common presenting symptom in such cases. Orbital cellulitis is present in the late stages but can also happen in the early retinoblastoma because it's a sterile inflammation. Very need to be treated early, especially with the steroids, because we have seen cases orbital cellulitis not treated early can lead to a scleral perforation, and then you need to treat this as an orbital retinoblastoma. Patient do present with the red, painful eye, hyphema, and then we do suspect that this is just a case of trauma to the child. But again, never leave a case of hyphema, or especially full chamber hyphema in a children, saying that this could be because of the trivial trauma that we did not understand. You need to do an ultrasound scan in such cases. It could be a pseudohypopyon. Again, such cases should not be only considered as a uveitis. UA or the B scan surely finds out the mass in the retina. Strabismus is another presentation that we should not miss in the early age. Now, differential diagnosis. What is the differential diagnosis? Suppose we make a list. It will take whole of our day to discuss every each one of this. So we'll be discussing major factors. Like this was a study done which showed that these are the most common massacrates of the retinoblastoma: coats, persistent fetal vasculature, vitreous hemorrhage, toxocariasis, and familial exudative vitreoretinopathy. So coats disease. Now, this picture I would like to show, and we'll come back to this picture after we finish with the Coats disease, that which one of this is Coats, which one of this is retinoblastoma. Another, again, here you see the exudative retinal, exudative retinal detachment and the subretinal mass and multiple dilated blood vessels. Again, question comes that which one of this is retinoblastoma and which is the Coats. Now, what are the features of the Coats disease? Very important features of the Coats disease here you see is the subretinal material in the Coats disease is yellow in color. In retinoblastoma, it is whitish, though not the only difference, but one of the important thing to look for in your EUAs. It has dilated peripheral vessels, telangiectasia, and they are of irregular caliber blood vessels. Very, very important features of the Coats disease that they have a telangiectatic vessels and they are much more of irregular caliber compared to the retinoblastoma. You do a B scan of these cases, you might find a total funnel-shaped retinal detachment, but there will be no retinal mass, which is not of classical of retinoblastoma. This retinal telangiectasia can be very well seen, and if you are in doubt, the FFA is of very much of help to show you the telangiectasia widespread and the florid, which helps you to differentiate post-disease from the retinoblastoma. Again, the reflex in the core disease could be yellow and this could be white. Core disease most commonly is unilateral compared to retinoblastoma. Again, a FFA picture of the same. Now, these are the various presentations of the core disease, then what I show you. One of this is anterior chamber cholestasis, where you see with multiple cholesterol crystals in the anterior chamber. This is again a classical presentation of Coats disease. Sometimes patient present with the painful blind eye with the neovascular glaucoma, and again a total retinal detachment but no mass. Seeing all this and again revising all this, that we need to see is peripheral telangiectatic vessels, retinal detachment, yellow glow, and FFA if needed. Then there is one more classic article which describes the MRI features of Coats disease. It specifically talks about no to minimal contrast enhancement of the solid lesion, and the contrast enhancement that is seen in the Coats is basically outside the solid lesion than the inside, which is seen in the retinoblastoma. So there are certain features which helps to differentiate your retinoblastoma from your Coats disease on the MRI. Now, retinoblastoma classically in the MRI, it will be a larger eye size compared to the contralateral eye. In Coats disease, it will be contrary. A V-shaped retinal detachment is again very classical of retinoblastoma on imaging compared to the Y-shaped retinal detachment that you see in the Coats disease. And the vitreous seeding, this can be seen on the very high resolution MRI, at least 3 Tesla, where you can see a vitreous seeding also. So this kind of MRI help you to differentiate your retinoblastoma from the Coats disease. Now coming back to our primary picture, there are yellow subretinal exudates and the calcification, which was very important feature here to diagnose, and this is retinoblastoma and Coats. Then here you go as a peripheral telangiectasias compared in this exudative retinal detachment. And here what you are looking at, your left-hand side is retinoblastoma and your right-hand side is Coats disease. Another differential important diagnosis is the PHPV or the persistent fetal vasculature. Now again a picture where you don't know, you see a UA, that is it a retinoblastoma? It's a benign lesion of the PHPV. Patient again presenting with the leukocoria. So what are the features of PHPV? PHPV cases generally again are unilateral. They do have a presentation as a microophthalmia and secondary cataract, which is rare in retinoblastoma. You can find out this persistent hyoid system on doing a B scan. On examination, you do see a mid-entrop dot or the barely visible hyoid artery. Very important sign here is a dragging of the ciliary process, which happens, which is very classical of your PHPV compared to the retinoblastoma. Again, a few classical signs on the MRI is you can see a ciliary body and lens deformation, optic nerve atrophy, and a central stalk between optic disc and the posterior lens in cases of PHPV. So what were this lesion? Both of them were PHPV. This is not the traction exactly. This is basically a persistent hyoid artery extending till the lens. This is how the patient was in the anterior segment and development of the lenticular opacity. Familial exudative vitreo retinopathy. Basically, you know, the problem is with the periphery and it's basically retinal ischemia and the angiogenesis is not happening in the periphery of the retina. This is familial, so it is very important that you do examine the siblings of the patient also. The family history and the FFA are two important clues to differentiate your FEVR from your retinoblastoma. Oculotoxopheriasis, another important differential diagnosis. This can present as a macular granulomasis with the retinal traction and the vitreous traction in the early cycloidic manner. Everything said and done, it is very difficult to differentiate toxopheriasis and from the retinoblastoma it's a stable lesion, and the serial EUAs can easily help to differentiate it from the retinoblastoma. And these are certain miscellaneous presentations of idiopathic intraocular abscess, myelinated nerve fibers, large optic disc with coloboma, cataract, grade 5 ROP with total retinal detachment, toxoplasma choroiditis. All this do present with the leukochorea, and a good EUA examination can differentiate it from the retinoblastoma. So to conclude, EUA is must and necessary in every suspect case. Adequate imaging is important, and keep the mind open and do not be affected by a primary retinal diagnosis. Second opinion is always of help in case of. I acknowledge my mentor, Dr. Santosh Unnavasan, and all the speakers, because they contributed to my knowledge each and every day in some part of my life. So thank you all for being here, and I stop my screen sharing. Can we move on to the next presentation now?
Yes, sure. We can move on to the next presentation. Dr. Ankit Singh Tomar, I would request you to please carry forward with your presentation.
So Dr. Ankit Tomar finished his MS from RP Center AIIMS, and then he did his fellowship with Dr. Santosh Unnavasan in Center for Sight, and with Dr. Paul Finger. And now currently he is preparing all the way to go to the USA again. Dr. Ankit, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ankit Singh Tomar, and I practice as an oculoplasty and ocular oncology specialist in Ujjain, Madhya Pradesh. Thank you, Dr. Sumit, for letting me be a part of this course and for your kind words. Before I start, I would like to thank my mentors, Dr. Santosh Shanavar and Dr. Paul Finger, who have taught me everything that I know in ocular oncology. In this course, we'll be covering the salient clinical and emergent features of choroidal pigmented tumors, how to differentiate a suspicious nevus from melanoma, and a brief approach to management. Let's begin with the most common benign lesion of choroid, the choroidal nevus. It arises from choroidal melanocytes. It is often flat with ill-defined margins. It can be slate gray or pigmented, but some can be amelanotic as well. And common signs of chronicity include a presence of overlying drusen or a hyperpigmented halo around its margin. As you can see that the size can extend from a small lesion to an extensive lesion, and some can be completely amelanotic. Let's address these pictures one by one. On the top left corner, we see a pigmented lesion about 2 disc diameter in size, which is nasal to disc. You can appreciate the irregular margins and the overlying white-yellow drusen deposits. And OCT section through it shows the bumpy hyperreflective layer, which is a drusenoid retinal pigment epithelial detachment. The image on the right upper corner is an autofluorescein image. I know that because the vessel appears dark. The bright white spots are the hyper autofluorescent spots, which are suggestive of lipofuscin or orange pigments, which are seen clinically. These are suggestive of abnormal metabolic activity on the surface of the nevus. We'll see more of similar pictures later. The right bottom picture is a fluorescein angiography picture in the late phase. It is grossly unremarkable except for some hyperfluorescent spots which signify microaneurysms, which can be seen with NEVA. So now what do I do with this kind of lesion if I see that in clinic? So it is essentially benign, and hence a baseline documentation with clinical photograph and ultrasound is sufficient. These lesions do grow, though quite slowly, in about 30% cases. Do I need to worry about a growing nevus? Yes, because there's a risk of transformation to its malignant counterpart. Annual rate of malignant transformation is between 1 in 5,000 to 1 in 10,000 by different studies. And about 2 to 13% of these lesions do transform into malignant melanoma. How do we identify this specific subset of suspicious nevi, which are at a risk of malignant transformation? So I follow my mentor, Dr. Finger's mnemonic MOST, where M stands for melanoma, O for orange pigments, S for subretinal fluid, and T for tumor thickness more than 2 millimeters. Simple and easy to remember. Presence of these three features is highly suggestive of malignant transformation of the nevus. Other suspicious features include proximity to optic nerve and fovea, presence of symptoms in form of flashes, floaters, or loss of vision, and absence of drusen or hyperpigmented halo. Let's tackle them one by one. So the first being orange pigments. As we discussed previously, these are suggestive of abnormal metabolic activity over the surface, and they are best seen on autofluorescence imaging. there are very few lesions which light up on autofluorescence, like drusen or optic disc astrocytic hamartoma. Hence, autofluorescence becomes an invaluable tool while examining a pigmented choroidal lesion and should be employed to follow up a lesion to monitor change. Even a change in the pattern of autofluorescence over time is suspicious, and we should make sure to have a discussion with patient and follow them up closely if that is observed. Any fluid, whether obvious subretinal fluid or subtle intraretinal fluid, is suggestive of abnormal leaky capillaries and hence metabolically active tumor. An OCT raster scan over the nevus surface with special attention to the inferior aspect of the lesion helps us catch even the smallest of these fluid pockets. The third aspect is thickness more than 2 millimeters. Ultrasound B scan is a great tool to measure thickness. On the left side, you can see that this is a very flat lesion. When we do an OCT scan over the same lesion, we see that the tumor is well delineated and there is a small fluid of pocket over it. Note the granular irregularities on the inner retina. These are dysmorphic photoreceptors suggestive of chronicity of the fluid. If all these three features, that is orange pigments, subretinal fluid, and tumor thickness more than 2 millimeters is present, then there is a very high chance of malignant transformation, and we should discuss the implications and management plans with the patient. However, if only one or two of these are present, ideally we should follow up the patient closely and look for any change. And if there is no change in 2 to 4 monthly follow-ups, then we can increase the follow-up to 6 months, but we should still keep a lookout for this patient's lesion. Now let's talk about the big bad lesion, that is uveal melanoma. Iris and ciliary body melanomas form a small proportion of all cases. Choroidal melanoma is a disease of middle age and elderly. Having said that, we do see some young people who can get this rare tumor. They tend to have a better prognosis due to better systemic immunity, which also fights the metastatic lesions. Racially, this disease is seen more commonly in Caucasians, and there is a higher risk of melanoma in patients with nevus of aorta and neurofibromatosis 1. Uveal melanoma is primarily a clinical diagnosis. So a careful indirect ophthalmoscopy is a must. These lesions can be large and pigmented, or sometimes even amelanotic. In the right side image, the inferior lesion is just a pigmented retinal scar, whereas the actual tumor is parafoveal and a little amelanotic. Ultrasound can help us get an accurate tumor height and basal dimensions, which help us plan the tumor management. And sometimes it can acquire a classical mushroom or colistate appearance after it has breached the internal limiting membrane of retina. Sometimes it can have accompanying exudative retinal detachment, as you can see in this image, and the shifting fluid. To describe this ultrasound video, it's a dome-shaped choroidal lesion with low to moderate internal reflectivity. You can see that there is an adjacent exudative detachment, and we cannot observe any extrascleral extension. If you notice closely, there is some amount of twinkling which is seen in the matter of the tumor, which is suggestive of tumor internal vascularity. In few cases, we can sometimes see the classical double circulation pattern with fluorescein angiography. Here, the dye lights up the overlying larger retinal vessels as well as the internal network of tumor vessels. We do not need fluorescein angiography for diagnosing uveal melanoma, but it can aid in suspicious cases or to differentiate it from other lesions, say for instance, hemangioma. While we talk about the management of choroidal melanoma, I need to address the collaborative ocular melanoma study, which is a large multi-center study and is an excellent example across medicine as to how to study rare disorders. Here they enrolled nearly 2,500 patients in the 1980s in America and Canada across 43 centers. Three tumor classes were defined based on tumor height and basal dimension. The small melanomas were observed. Medium size were randomized between enucleation and plaque brachytherapy. And the large tumors had enucleation with or without irradiation. In the small melanoma group, they found that on observation, 1/3 grew over 5 years and 2/3 did not change at all. The risk factors for growth were presence of orange pigment, more than 2 millimeters of thickness, and more than 12 millimeters of basal dimension. Melanoma-specific mortality was found to be 1% over 5 years. In the medium-sized melanoma group, where they were around 1,300 patients, they found that either of the treatment did not offer survival advantage over the other. In other words, whether you enucleate or use radiation, the patient had similar chances of getting metastasis. The larger size group also found no survival difference between two arms. To conclude, small melanomas have a small risk of metastasis in 5 years if untreated, that was around 1%. Radiation is equivalent to enucleation in terms of metastatic risk, and enucleation did not worsen the risk of metastasis. But like I said, this study was conducted in the 1980s and some time has passed since this study. So what does the current medical evidence suggest? So we believe that treatment modality has no role in prognosis of uveal melanoma, and it is the genetic profile of the tumor which decides the risk of metastasis. So our main aim is to treat the tumor. But there's one more unanswered question. When does the tumor start metastasizing? For instance, if a patient has a small tumor and wants to delay the treatment. A study was done on the same topic, and they found that metastasis was detected on an average 2.2 years after the primary diagnosis. And these deposits developed from micrometastasis, which had happened when the tumor was much smaller. How smaller, you ask? About 7 cubic millimeter, which is nearly 3 millimeters basal diameter and 1.5 millimeter height. So this finding concludes that if we find a melanoma, we should not delay treatment irrespective of the size to reduce the risk of metastasis. I'll be covering iris melanomas and ciliary body melanomas in brief. Iris melanomas have a relatively better prognosis and are detected earlier than choroidal melanomas. They can be circumscribed or diffuse. They are more commonly seen in the inferior iris. And it is very important to look for neovascularization of the iris and ectropion and uvea. As you can see in the fluorescein picture, the tumor vessels are very leaky. It can also result in microhyphema. Gonioscopy is a must because it can help us look for tumor deposits, neovascularization of the angle, and pigment dispersion. These lesions can be managed with plaque brachytherapy, local excision, or in diffuse cases, enucleation. We recently described a new technique of total anterior segment plaque brachytherapy for diffuse iris melanomas. Here we used a custom 20 millimeter large plaque, which was placed over the amniotic graft covered cornea to irradiate the entire anterior segment. It had excellent local control with no corneal side effects. Ciliary body tumors, due to their unique location, may remain undetected and can acquire large dimensions before diagnosis. Due to proximity to vortex veins, they have a higher risk of metastasis. Prominent episcleral vessels can be seen in the quadrant of the tumor, and they can be managed with enucleation or plaque brachytherapy. To summarize, a suspicious choroidal lesion can be identified by the presence of the mnemonic MOST, simple and easy to remember, where M is for melanoma, O for presence of orange pigments, S for subretinal fluid, and T for thickness more than 2 millimeters. These lesions are slow growing, and hence serial documentation can help us in detecting subtle changes. Thank you for your patient listening, and thank you, Dr. Sumit, for this opportunity.
Thank you, Ankit. That was really nice. And we'll get back to you with the questions, but since with the time, we will go ahead with the next presentation of Dr. Sonal. Dr. Sonal did her fellowship with Dr. Santosh Sonawasara at Center for Sight, and then she was with Dr. Paul Singer for a year at New York. And then presently, she is working as a consultant in HV Desai Hospital, Pune. Over to you, Dr. Sonal.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit, for the kind introduction and the chance to present at this instruction course. So after learning about the red vascular lesions, colorful choroidal metastasis, and brown to gray choroidal melanoma and choroidal nevi, let's turn our heads towards the black lesions of retina and optic nerve. So in general, the primary intraocular pigmented lesions can arise from two type of cells, the melanocytes of uveal tract and the pigment epithelium. Talking specifically about the black pigmented lesions of the retina. Retinal pigment epithelium is the most common culprit for these lesions after the commonest melanocytic lesions of uveal tract.
So apart from the retinal pigment epithelial hyperplasia after trauma, inflammation, the pigmented lesions which we are going to focus here are the congenital hypertrophy of retinal pigment epithelium, RP adenomas or adenocarcinoma, RP hematoma, and the optic nerve hair melanocytoma, though not an RPE lesion, however, an important black lesion seen in the posterior segment of the eye. So starting with the congenital hypertrophy of retinal pigment epithelium. So these can be of mainly three types, solitary or a single, what we commonly know as chirpy, a group or multiple or beer track appearing chirpies, and another important variety that is a familial adenosis polyposis associated or atypical congenital hypertrophic retinal epithelium. So learning about a solitary lesion, these are congenital. However, the median age of diagnosis is notified as 45 years. They are generally a symptomatic and incidental finding during a routine fundus examination or during screening of fundus examination for systemic diseases. The location is generally observed in mid-periphery or periphery of the fundus, very rarely in posterior pole location. On examination, they appear to be very well demarcated, minimally elevated. These lesions don't tend to have a significant height which can be caught on an ultrasound. Color-wise, it is a black homogeneous lesion with a typical depigmented halo, which is also seen around the lesion. They are known to show gradual but slow growth in their diameter. What needs to be kept in mind while observing these lesions is 2% of these lesions, however small, but 2% of these lesions can also show nodular growth, progressive nodular growth, and can turn into RP adenomas or adenocarcinoma, which is a malignant variant of RP tumor. On ancillary examination, as seen over here, the fundus fluorescent angiography shows a uniform hypofluorescence owing to the densely packed and pigmented nature of these tumors. On OCT, we can see loss of photoreceptors, presence of the subretinal clefts, as well as increased transmission through the lacunae. So how do we manage these solitary chirpies? Periodic observation is mandated for routine monitoring. If a small nodular growth is noted and it is causing exudation or collection of subretinal fluid, laser photocoagulation or cryotherapy can be applied if the vision is getting threatened because of the same. If the small nodular growth is also causing surface wrinkling or retinal maculopathy, vitreous membrane peeling might be necessary. Multifocal or group chirpies are also known as beer track chirpies. So these are again well-defined, flat, slate-gray lesions. Very important to note are their distribution. They are usually sectorally distributed. The numbers can be between 3 to 30. The diameter ranges between 0.1 to 3 millimeter in diameter. However, there are no lacunae or halos of depigmentation as we saw them as in solitary chirpies. These also appear to be minimally elevated. Group chirpies can also be non-pigmented, and in these cases, they are known as polar bear tracks because of their sans pigment nature. These are known to be stable lesions, only require monitoring as their management. Important variety, that is the familial adenosis polyposis associated or Gardner syndrome associated RPE lesions. These are hallmarks of more systemic associations. Why do we need to worry about FAP? Is patients with FAP tend to be at a higher risk of development of colonic cancers. 70% of patients with FAP can have the atypical chirpies inside the eyes. As these are easily recognizable lesions, can be a clue towards the patient's diagnosis of a systemic illness. These tend to be multiple and often bilateral. By now, the other two varieties that we have seen are unilateral. These tend to have lesser defined margins, randomly distributed, not the sectoral distribution. The FAP gene has been identified in a long arm of chromosome 5. So periodic observation again for these lesions, and because of their close association with colonic cancer, periodic colonoscopy and removal of suspicious polyps in the family, in the patient as well as family is warranted. Moving on to RP adenoma or adenocarcinoma. So these are quite very rare lesions. Few case reports and one or two case series have been published describing these in the literature. The mean age is noted to be 53 years. They may occur with a history of prior trauma or inflammation or a prior existing reactive hyperplasia of RPE. So they tend to be solitary and unilateral, a very dark brown to black retinal tumor. In the developmental aspect, they do invade the overlying retina and acquire a retinal feeder as well as draining vessel. The acquiring of retinal feeder vessel kind of separates them from a similar looking choroidal melanoma. Commonly present are intraretinal as well as subretinal exudation. Rarely they can be locally invasive if adenocarcinomatous changes have been there as a pathogenesis, and extraocular extension has also been noted. Very rarely do these lesions metastasize. So a little about how to differentiate them from their commonly encountered differential diagnosis, that is the choroidal melanoma. So as we saw, these do arise internal to Bruch membrane. Some of the choroidal melanoma, which also can arise and show the mushroom configuration, may invade the retina. These are more deep and dark pigmentation. 45% of choroidal melanomas can be amelanotic. A lipid exudation or intraretinal and subretinal exudation, which is a characteristic of RP adenoma or adenocarcinoma, is rare to see at presentation with choroidal melanomas. These features may be seen post-radiotherapy as a sign of radiation retinopathy in a treated case of choroidal melanoma. Presence of a feeder artery and draining vessel is again quite characteristics of RPE adenoma or adenocarcinoma. The feeder artery is rare to find for a choroidal melanoma, but they can have a draining vessel. Vitreous hemorrhage or vitreous tumor seeding has been noted increasingly in RP adenoma and adenocarcinoma, another differentiating feature. Vitreous hemorrhage can be present with tumor necrosis in choroidal melanoma. However, vitreous seeding has been very rarely described. Again, on fundus fluorescence angiography, because of the nature of the lesion, they will show a uniform hypofluorescence in all phases. Management-wise, for asymptomatic lesions, that is the adenoma component lesions, periodic observation is warranted. For anteriorly located lesions who have shown growth on due examination, local resection with partial lamellar sclerouvectomy or plaque brachytherapy can be applied. For posterior lesions which are causing exudative retinal detachment or subretinal fluid collection, laser photocoagulation, transpupillary thermotherapy, cryotherapy, or plaque brachytherapy can be applied. In cases of advanced tumors leading to painful blind eye, enucleation might be warranted, which also helps in finally diagnosing these lesions. RP hematoma or a simple RP hematomas are basically distinct solitary nodules seen in these tend to be less than 1 millimeter in diameter and a small 1 to 2 millimeter elevation. Minimally dilated retinal feeding vessel and adjacent retinal traction can be seen along with these lesions. On OCT, abruptly elevated solid mass within the retina and a complete optical shadowing is noted. These are again incidentally found and noted lesions. Monitoring as a management protocol does suffice. Turning our heads to the optic nerve head pigmented lesion, that is optic nerve head melanocytoma. So these are melanocytic hematomas or hyperpigmented magnocellular nevus of the optic nerve head. Mean age of diagnosis is 50 years, though it is postulated that the lesion is present since congenital. Mostly unilateral, very rarely bilateral presentation has been noted. Visual loss might be the primary complaint the patient seeks treatment for. Visual loss, if at all present, is due to the subretinal exudation at fovea, neuroretinitis from tumor necrosis of the lesion. In massive lesions, secondary CRVO or tumor necrosis can again lead to severe visual loss or malignant transformation. So severe visual loss is another indication of probable malignant transformation of optic nerve head melanocytoma, which is very, very rare though. These lesions do show a presence of RAPD. Around 30% lesions have been shown to show RAPD. 10 to 15% can show slow growth over the years, and malignant change noted only in 1 to 2%. Visual field defects are common, from minimal enlargement of blind spots to absolute arcuate defects. OCT, though not completely diagnostic, but can show a very indicative of hyperreflective margin of the lesion with hyporeflective internal reflectivity. Sometimes we can see
Dr. Sonal, sorry to interrupt you. Just a reminder that we have 1 more minute left for your presentation to be concluded.
Yeah, got you. When elevated, the lesion can be caught on ultrasound B scan. MRI is indicated to know if there is any macroscopic invasion of the lesion in the optic nerve portion. Fundus fluorescein angiography shows dense pigmented lesion and a hypofluorescence. So again, periodic observation, small degree of growth to be can be observed. More progressive growth or profound visual loss is an indication of probable malignant transformation. Enucleation and histopathology is then indicated. It's a small chart showing the varied differential diagnosis of black retinal lesions as we just discussed. Important of them being diagnosis and monitoring of the congenital hypertrophy retinal epithelium. The diagnostic features of RP adenoma and adenocarcinoma, as well as the optic nerve head melanocytoma. I would like to acknowledge my mentors who helped me gain all this knowledge about ocular oncology. And thank you again, Dr. Sumit, for including my talk in the instruction course.
That was bang on time, Dr. Sumit, and thank you for such a nice and extensive presentation. Now, the most awaited presentation of our IC and maybe of the whole Duazol or AIOS, I would like to invite Dr. Santosh Onawa, sir, for his lecture on primary intraocular lymphoma. He doesn't need any introduction, but still I would like to say that he is the reason that all of us are here. Thank you, sir, for being there for every one of us, for every time we needed. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumit. Thank you for organizing such a wonderful course. And I congratulate all the previous speakers for their very nice talks, and I'll try to live up. I'm talking about primary intraocular lymphoma, which is a subtype of central nervous system lymphoma. So we should know that it is not alone. It always comes with a big baggage, that is primary central nervous system lymphoma. And when it is confined to the eye, it is also called primary vitreoretinal lymphoma. So these are synonymously used. In the eye, it typically involves various structures such as subretinal pigment epithelium, retina, vitreous, and optic nerve. So what goes unnoticed is the optic nerve involvement. Unless you do an MRI with contrast, you may not be able to pick up optic nerve sheath involvement. And it is a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma and rarely a T-cell lymphoma. Whereas we have to differentiate it from secondary intraocular lymphoma, which involves the choroid, which looks like this. It's a mass unilateral or bilateral, which may look like choroidal metastasis that was shown earlier. It can be unilateral or bilateral multifocal. So this is choroidal lymphoma, which is a secondary form of lymphoma, whereas primary CNS lymphoma looks different. How common is it? It is, as a brain tumor, it is quite common. It forms about 4 to 6%, at least in the Western literature, of primary brain tumors. And among extranodal lymphoma, it is less than 2%. It has shown increasing incidence in the recent times, possibly because of immunocompromised individuals. And the number of patients have multiplied by 3 over the last 3 decades. Generally occurs in 3 to 8 decades of life. Most common age group is 50 to 60. And it occurs in younger individuals if they're immunocompromised. Now, etiologies are infective etiology, which is mediated by Epstein-Barr virus, Toxoplasma gondii, and infection-driven B-cell clonal expansion, that is a theory. Inflammatory, it is driven by chemokine hypothesis. Chemokines are nothing but small protein molecules which attract or recruit lymphocytes. And when the lymphocytes go out of control and have a clonal proliferation, that results in a tumor. And association with immunocompromised status I already mentioned. Now, this association is important to realize. 15 to 30% of primary intraocular lymphoma have concurrent primary CNS lymphoma at the same time. So it's mandatory that we screen the CNS very carefully at the primary onset itself. 15 to 30% of primary CNS lymphoma have concurrent primary intraocular lymphoma. So if a patient goes to a neurologist or an oncologist, they necessarily should have the eye screened. Now, most important aspect here is that.
Otani amake phone korechilo ekjon okhane guest speaker ache. To ami tar byapare
kichu in 10 to 30 months. So this is very important to note, which means that these patients, after having intraocular lymphoma managed, we have to screen them for a very long time, even up to 5 to 7 years with periodic MRI scan, so that the CNS lymphoma, which is life-threatening, does not go missed. Now, ocular symptoms are blurred vision. These patients have symptomatology, which is not very uncommon. Most of the patients come to us with blurred vision, which may be minimal. They might have just lost a line or two of vision, accompanied by floaters, which is also not very uncommon. So these patients have very, very common symptoms, which may often get brushed aside. They don't have dramatic symptoms of loss of vision, dramatic symptoms such as red eye or painful eye. And CNS symptoms are also very mild. So to say, forgetfulness, headache, you know, unless they are very severe forms of affection when you have hemiparesis, ataxia, and seizures. This is one of the manifestations. It's not very common, but anterior segment involvement with the form of a white eye hypopyon, whereas there are no signs of uveitis, no synechia, etc. There could be a small little membrane over the lens, but apart from that, it is an absolutely white eye, white hypopyon. That's one of the manifestations. When you look at the fundus, it might look exactly like vitritis, like this, a haze. Haze, when there is diffuse ground glass appearance of the vitreous, through which you can vaguely see the disc, and rest of the retina background is very, very vaguely seen. Whereas cloud is when there are clear areas, when, you know, through the clear areas, you can actually see some of the normal retina, and here you see the fovea and you see the optic nerve very hazily. This is one more example of a cloud. So it's either a haze or a cloud or a clump. And these are clumps of cells which look like vitreous and retinoblastoma, beyond which you see normal retina. Then when you look at the retina, when the retina is seen clearly, you find RP and sub-RP infiltrates, which are multinodular. And some of these nodules may coalesce together to find larger nodules. They may look like very discrete nodules. Since it's a chronic condition, you find RP atrophy, which indicates that there was some subretinal fluid earlier, which is shrinking down. Now, most important diagnostic tool is non-interventional, that is autofluorescence. And lesions which are above the RP are typically hyperautofluorescent, whereas lesions which are below the RP are typically hypoautofluorescent. And when you do fundus fluorescein angiography, you find that there is reversal. What appeared hyperfluorescent on autofluorescence becomes hypofluorescent. And this is typically called a leopard spot pattern. And OCT is quite diagnostic. You find nodular, discrete, or coalescent nodular excrescences, which have a typical feature. These are, as we already mentioned, these are at the level of retinal pigment epithelium, above it or below it, or on both the sides of it. Separation of Bruch's membrane from the retinal pigment epithelium, with partial destruction of retinal pigment epithelium, disruption of photoreceptor and ISOS junction line, and multiple hyperreflective signals in the inner retina. This is the typical OCT appearance that has been described. When you do an MRI, you find meningeal enhancement as the first MRI sign. If the optic nerve is involved, the optic nerve sheath enhances. And this is, if it's advanced disease, you find T1 hypointense, T2 hypor isointense, vivid homogeneous enhancing lesions with restricted diffusion if you do diffusion weighted images, and a high choline peak if you do spectrometry, MR spectrometry. Maskrach, vitritis, infective uveitis, endophthalmitis, metastasis, and optic neuritis. If it's optic nerve involvement, in fact, it does look like optic neuritis. And the diagnosis is mainly based on clinical appearance and autofluorescence, OCT, etc. MRI is very important, followed by a PET scan for systemic screening. Then you do biopsy. These are the diagnostic yields of various biopsies, which is FNAC, vitrectomy, subretinal material. But most important biopsy technique that we employed is a vitrectomy. But if you do vitrectomy, you have to make sure that there is no use of systemic steroids for at least for 3 weeks. You have to give a washout period. If the patient has vitritis simulation, then he might have been given steroids by the primary physician. and that has to be taken into consideration. Now, what are the measures to increase diagnostic yield? This is just the summation of the literature. I keep it very simple, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80. And these are the various techniques. So basically, if you do a vitrectomy, you have to make sure that cell block is prepared, which gives you a 50% diagnostic yield. And on the same material, if you do flow cytometry, that increases the diagnostic yield. If you do PCR gene rearrangement, then you get the highest diagnostic yield. So you do a good vitrectomy, core vitrectomy, then do a cell block, and then do immunohistochemistry, and then do a PCR. Let's skip that flow chart. I don't have time for that. But the management guidelines, again, keeping very simple. Of course, it's very intricate disease, but if you want to keep it very simple, if it's unilateral, intravitreal methotrexate or rituximab or external beam radiation, if it is bilateral primary intraocular lymphoma without CNS lymphoma, then external beam radiation may be preferred because bilateral vitreous injections slightly cumbersome. You cannot give both injections on the same day. If it is PIOL with CNS lymphoma concurrently, then you give chemotherapy, which is mandated. Then EBRT to the eye with brain and spine has to be included in radiation field, and intrathecal methotrexate and rituximab. For the eye, you can, of course, give intravitreal injection. These are the three protocols of intravitreal injection. Methotrexate classically described as 25 injection, which becomes a little too much. So we use what is called a minimal dose methotrexate approach, where we give weekly injections until complete clinical resolution plus one. If it is both eye involvement, then we alternate between the right eye and the left eye. Rituximab is a slightly spaced out injection, 3 weekly, 1 milligram in 0.1 ml. And stability is an acceptable endpoint. If the lesion reduces and reaches a phase of stability where it does not reduce any further, that is an acceptable endpoint. This is one of the patients who was treated with intravitreal injection and external beam radiation. It's one more patient treated with intravitreal injection. So prognosis, ocular remission seen in 70 to 90% of patients after the intravitreal injection. 10 to 80% die within 12 to 36 months. So it's not a good disease to have. Large series have shown relapse at 18 months. So this is the time to watch out for. 18 months, they relapse typically in the eye and CNS. And overall survival is about 30 months. But what is encouraging is that combined treatment, that is when you do chemotherapy, intraocular injection and radiation, pushes the survival to at least 36 months. Whereas if you do just EBRT or chemotherapy alone, one of those, then you have the survival. But ocular remission has no bearing on survival. So ocular remission should not be taken very, very seriously and pumped with intravitreal injections. You can have an endpoint where you can stop giving intravitreal injection because it has absolutely no bearing on survival at all. So in conclusion, I would say that primary intraocular lymphoma, Mascarat's or vitritis, in fact, that's the most common Mascarat, which delays the diagnosis. It happens in immunocompromised individuals who have early and aggressive manifestation. Most important to remember is its association with CNS lymphoma, which has to be tracked beyond ocular remission for several years so that you can pick up this lethal disease. Vitreous biopsy is very important, and you have to know how to process it readily without delay in processing. EBRT with a combination of chemotherapy, intraocular and systemics definitely helps push the survival. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. That was amazing, like always. Any questions, Dr. Akshay?
Sir, if I may ask you a question about choroidal mets.
Yeah,
sir, in your experience, what do you think, whether when you find choroidal mets, of course, with once we locate the primary tumor, should we actually wait for about 4 to 6 months of chemotherapy for the choroidal mets to resolve, or should we go ahead and do local treatment anyway so that we also not only just salvage the eye but also have a chance at optimizing the vision?
Right.
So earlier the treatment, better the chance.
I totally agree with you. Actually, both the approaches are reasonable. If a lesion is remote from the macula, has no cause for concern in terms of vision, then you can wait. But if the patient has shifting subretinal fluid, because metastasis, depending on the location of primary, can have subretinal fluid or not. Like GI malignancies, when they metastasize, are notorious to have a lot of subretinal fluid. Whereas squamous carcinoma of the breast is unique in the sense that there is no subretinal fluid. So when you make the patient lie down and see if the fluid goes to the macula when the patient assumes a dependent position, that's a great idea to treat the metastasis primarily without waiting for the systemic treatment. Whereas if the lesion is somewhere in the mid periphery and has no SRF at all and has no bearing on vision, then you might wait as well. So both the approaches are both acceptable and practical.
Okay.
Depending on the situation. Yeah.
Any other question, anyone? Dr. Sonan, Ankit? Dr. Sonal and to sir, I would like to ask a question. Like Dr. Sonal spoke about her black lesions of the retina, and many times it is not very much diagnostic for a general ophthalmologist. So can do they manage, or every lesion of suspicious, even chirpy, should be referred? Or how do they basically follow up such lesions?
So as we did see, these lesions do have some of the characteristic feature and ancillary testing, which might be easily available even in a general ophthalmology clinic, for example, autofluorescence or FFA or OCT. What we would recommend is, if the, in case of doubt, for confirmation of diagnosis, a referral of such lesions would be advisable to get a confirmed diagnosis done, after which the periodic monitoring can be maintained by general ophthalmologists by serial photographic documentation and monitoring the dimensions and qualities of the lesion, and any, all like the warning signs we saw, any growth or nodular growth or progressive massive change in the lesion dimension or the visual acuity. Sir, do you want to add anything to that?
I think you did well.
Okay, and sir, in cases when we have this choroidal nevus, which is like Ankit described how to differentiate from the melanoma, but still sometimes there is a doubt and you're not able to differentiate, and what should we do in such scenario? It's 4 millimeter large nevus and then still you're not able to differentiate. What should be the approach in such cases?
Indeterminate choroidal lesions, despite your best efforts, if you're not able to identify, OCT sometimes helps, pick up borderline lesions. But close observation is okay if it's a smaller lesion where you really can't differentiate. But I would err on treating. I would rather treat a smaller lesion with indeterminate etiology, whether it's nevus or melanoma, than wait. Because waiting would mean that, you risk metastasis, because even a 3 millimeter small lesion can start metastasizing. So I would rather treat, because smaller lesions are easier to treat even with TTT and laser, right? So it doesn't cause morbidity to the patient. You don't need plaque brachytherapy, etc.
And sir, as you said, in cases of intraocular lymphoma, that good vitrectomy or poor vitrectomy gives a good sample, though the yield is less. In some cases, we do have some that chorioretinal lymphoma. And then many times when you ask a retinal surgeon that take a retinal biopsy, they are little worried that it might cause a retinal break and a retinal attachment post-surgery. Yeah. In such cases, how do you convince them, or what should be the ideal way to take biopsy in such cases?
No, they should do a retinal biopsy. So retina specialists have an idea that they cannot do retinal biopsy. That is wrong. They should do retinal biopsy, and they are used to retinotomies. But when they do retinal biopsy, sometimes they might have to use oil or gas. So they can't restrict themselves to core vitrectomy. So they had to do a complete proper vitrectomy and then do a retinal biopsy so that they are ready for the, consequences. So if they just do a core vitrectomy, then you can't ask them to do a retinal or a subretinal biopsy. So that aspect you have to discuss with them.
And sir, in cases of as I described, the ports and retinoblastoma, though there are multiple differentiating features, even sometimes they look alike. And then sometimes parents are not willing, even in the stage 4 of ports, that they want to go ahead with denucleation. So So then how early should be the EUA follow-up in such cases that you don't want to risk it to metastasize also, but still you want to be sure that you are not leaving any, removing the eye of a benign tumor?
Yeah, so there is no guideline as such, but typically I would see them first in 6 weeks. And if everything is stable, then I would push the follow-up to 2 months or 3 months and keep looking at it very carefully for 1-1.5 years. Because if there is no progression in 1-1.5 years, it's unlikely to be retinoblastoma. So at the end of 1 year, if everything looks good, you can loosen the follow.
Any questions from any of our panelists or attendees? Fairuz ma'am and Ganguly ma'am also have joined. Welcome, ma'am. Any questions, Dr. Ankit, Dr. Sonal? Then I think we are touched at time limit of 4:25. Dr. Rakshan, Samiksha, if you can start your video, we can take a small group photograph here. Dr. Samiksha. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Santosh sir. Thank you, Dr. Ankit, Dr. Sonal, Dr. Sabiksha, and Dr. Raksha, and AIOC for giving us a stage and giving us a time to present. And I hand over the stage to our hall coordinator. Thank you, everyone, once again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.